Thank you so much for the invitation to be here today. I'm excited to talk to you all. So I will go over two little sections in the talk. I will talk about my trajectory first and then mention a few things that I think I've learned along the way. First, I'll go starting in my childhood and then move on to eventually the faculty position. In my childhood, I was homeschooled from the time that I was young. I think my mom tells me that I learned to read when I was four, and then she homeschooled us all the way through 12th grade. And I lived in a house that was full of books, lots of old books, lots of new books, books everywhere, books on the floor, books on the bookshelves. It was a really wonderful environment, I think, for learning. And my father was, so my mom homeschooled us, my father was an orthopedic surgeon. And so he would always come back from medical meetings with videos that he would, you know, put into the VCR machine to show pictures of and videos of new experiments, not experiments, but new surgeries that he needed to perform. And so I would sit next to him, even as like a six-year-old, I would sit next to him and watch these amazing new surgeries that he needed to learn and that medicine as a field was able to do now. And so I think I learned from a very young age how amazing medicine is and how amazing science is that allows us to better the health of one another. As I moved into high school, I realized though that one of my greatest passions was actually music. I played classical piano, and my goal when I was 13 was to go to Eastman Conservatory and be a classical pianist for the rest of my life. That's really, really what I wanted to do. My family was not really supportive of that goal. I came from my family and my wider community was very religious and of a particular kind of religion that believed that women should stay home, that they should get married and have children, but it's not appropriate for them to be outside of the home with any kind of career. And so even pursuing something like music was not what they hoped for me to do. But I kept that as a goal in my own heart, as something that I was very much hoping for. But then when I was 16, I was practicing very rigorously, about 11 hours a day for upcoming competitions. And I ended up fracturing my the bones in my arm from stress fractures from being a little bit too excited about Brahms, which still happens. But so that sort of dashed my hopes of becoming a concert pianist. We went to the hand specialist and they said that I would have to take at least a year off before practicing at all. And at that point I realized that it would be at least 1 year off and then at least 1 year after that to get back to where I was. And I was at an age of life where I had to try something else maybe. And so I decided to apply to a local nursing school. And the reason I did that is that I finally convinced my dad that it would be okay for a woman to be a nurse. He was really adamant that women should not be doctors, but that a nurse is something that is a little bit more acceptable for a woman's career, although his preference was not to have a career at all. But anyway, so I went and began nursing school. And while I was in nursing school, I was consistently faced with the beauty of the human body and the beauty of medicine and the amazing things that we can do with science today. But about a year and a half into nursing school, one of the faculty pulled me aside and looked me in the eyes and said, "Why are you here?" And I sort of was a little, I realized that she could tell that this wasn't my first passion, that I was here because it was a way, but it wasn't the way that I was hoping. And so I thought about it very hard and I decided that, you know, what I loved about nursing was the human body and was the science. It was not the day-to-day actions of being a nurse, which I have extreme respect for now. And I'm so thankful that many people do find their calling in that area. But I ended up quitting nursing school. And I applied to Penn State University. I applied to start as a mechanical engineer. I took my first class in physics and fell in love and really have not turned back since. So I realized then that it wasn't just that the human body was beautiful or that the world was beautiful and that science could help us to understand it, but that there were very precise mathematical formalisms that we could use to bring that understanding to us. And that actually there was so much simplicity in what looks so complicated. And the beautiful connection between mathematics and reality that physics gives us just blew my mind. And I've been in love with it ever since. So after that first class of physics, I decided to be a physics major. I finished up college. And when I was ending college, I was thinking, well, what should I do next? Many of my friends were going in and getting jobs, and I thought, oh, I just want to keep learning. Getting a job sounds terrible, sounds sad, sounds lonely, sounds like I would be away from all of the books and all of the learning and all of the amazing things that I've just been able to fill my mind with over the last few years. So I decided to go to grad school mostly just so that I wouldn't have to get a job. After I went to grad school, I tried to blend my love of mathematics, my love of physics, and my interest in biology, but particularly it was growing closer and closer to a biology of the mind. And I think part of the reason is that I was saw in many of my friends and colleagues, and in the textbooks as well, and in the hospitals, the effects of mental health, of psychiatric disorders and neurological disorders. And I started to realize that there was a part of biology that was still so far from tamed, so far from understood. And I hoped that there would be a place for an interdigitation between physics and the biology of the mind. And so that's really what I decided to focus my efforts on in graduate school. As a postdoc, I missed some very straightforward, simple physics. It wasn't simple physics, but in my postdoc, I did decide to work a little bit more in granular matter, which is beautiful in the sense that it is more pristine, more clear sometimes than biology can be. And I should note that the reason that I took a postdoc was not because I wanted to be a professor. I didn't know that that's what I wanted to be. I knew that I just wanted to keep learning. But I, at the end of graduate school, I applied both to industry positions and to postdocs, and I didn't get any interviews for industry positions, and I got a few interviews for postdocs, so my mind up was made for me. And then when I was finishing my postdoc, I think that is the first time that I really thought, actually, maybe I do want to be a faculty member. It really had not been a focus or a goal in my mind until then. But as I was finishing my postdoc, I thought, I have so many ideas. I have so many things I want, so many questions I want to answer, so many stones left unturned. And I couldn't imagine a life that where I couldn't get up every day and ask the questions that I wanted to ask. And so that's why I ended up moving into the faculty track. And I started at University of Pennsylvania as an assistant professor in 2013. And the work that we do in the lab is trying to blend or to bridge the physics of neuroscience, the biology of the mind, and also the philosophy of the mind. And so our work sort of sits in between each of these fields. And then I know I have hopefully a few more minutes. I wanted to mention a few of the things that I've learned along the way. And I wanted to call your attention to this beautiful book from Abraham Flexner called The Usefulness of Useless Knowledge, which I think has just an endless amount of inspirational passages that I wanted to share because they, I think, help me to crystallize what it is that I feel I've learned. The first is that I always try to remind myself why I first fell in love with science. And one of the passages that he writes that brings this to me is, now I sometimes wonder whether our conception of what is useful may not have become too narrow to be adequate to the roaming and capricious possibilities of the human spirit. And I think what I want in myself is the freedom to roam and to have those capricious possibilities, but that's also what I want to support in the lives of my students and what I respect and admire in the lives of my colleagues. I also try to remember that many people are forbidden to do the things that we are able to do with complete freedom, and that includes the pursuit of science. Abraham writes, the real enemy of the human race is not the fearless and irresponsible thinker, be he right or wrong. The real enemy is the man who tries to mold the human spirit so that it will not dare to spread its wings. And I think what I try to do, what I hope to do, what I hope all of us will do, is to ensure that everyone is given complete freedom to allow their spirit to spread its wings, to ask the scientific questions that are important to them, and to have their voices heard in those scientific areas. And then third, I try to remind myself that my work builds on the work of others. And Abraham writes, almost every discovery has a long and precarious history. Someone finds a bit here, another bit there, a third step succeeds later, and thus onward till a genius pieces the bits together and makes the decisive contribution. Science, like the Mississippi, begins in a tiny rivulet in the distant forest. Gradually, other streams swell its volume, and the roaring river that bursts the dikes is formed from countless sources. And I think that helps to remember where all of these ideas have come from, and we are just one piece of the long story. And then last, I try to remember that each of us has really different interests, and that's not just okay, it's beautiful. And Abraham writes, I am not for a moment suggesting that everything that goes on in laboratories will ultimately turn to some unexpected practical use, or that an ultimate practical use is its actual justification. Much more am I pleading for the abolition of the word use and for the freeing of the human spirit. To be sure, we shall thus free some harmless cranks, and to be sure, we shall waste some precious dollars. But what is infinitely more important is that we shall be striking the shackles off the human mind and setting it free for the adventures which in our own day have, on the one hand, taken Hale and Rutherford and Einstein and their peers millions upon millions of miles into the uttermost realms of space, and on the other, loosed the boundless energy imprisoned in the atom. But these ultimate and unforeseen and unpredictable practical results are not offered as a justification. These are artists, for such are scientists. Disseminate the spirit which prevailed in laboratories in which they were simply following the line of their own curiosity. And I think, just to summarize that, the first, remembering why we first fell in love with science, I think is just to recall that passion and keep it with us. The second, having gratitude, remembering that many people are forbidden to do the things that we have complete freedom to do. The third, humility, remembering that my work builds on the work of others. And the last is commitment to diversity, remembering that each of us has really different interests. So I think with all of these trajectories, talks you've probably heard and will continue to hear, that each trajectory into science is wild and wonderful, but some are also deeply sad and painful. And I think often we need to remind ourselves that we can't tell by looking at somebody which trajectory they've had. We can't see whether they've had a trajectory full of privilege or one full of discrimination. We can't see whether they've had a trajectory full of open doors or of abuse around every corner. And so it just reminds us to be kind, to be generous, and to look out for each other. And if you're curious about some of the work that we're doing in this space, so separate from the work of science, you can check out our website under the panel called Diversity. So with that, thank you so much for listening.
Thank you so much for that Living Histories talk, Dani. I mean, I'm still processing so many of the thoughts that I want to absolutely savor. In the interest of time, let me give people a chance to ask you a couple of quick questions. Anyone? Orit, were you going to say something?
Hi. Yeah, go ahead. Thank you. I just wanted to ask for, the whole diversity of people and interests that you find such beautiful. Which are the most strangest collaborations that you've had during your trajectory?
That's a really good question. I don't know what the most unusual collaborations are probably with philosophers, just because that feels so far away. So we have a paper that we just finished where we worked with some people who work in philosophy of science and the history of science. So they're historians and philosophers of science. And we went back to some of the old theories of how science happens that philosophers have been toying with for, you know, centuries. And we tried to determine whether we could provide validation data for them or not validation for them from studying the progression of science as evident through Wikipedia. So that was super fun because we could work with, you know, modern science ideas, we could use tools from natural language processing, we could use complex systems approaches, but we were also talking to the like historians of science and philosophers of science about how they think science really works. It was so much fun. Maybe the second quick example is that we just, Erin Teich is a postdoc in the lab who just submitted a paper where she's using techniques that people have previously used to understand crystalline structure in materials. And she's using it to understand the architecture of the human brain. There are particular parts of the brain that are more crystalline than others. And so she's using these tools that haven't really been ported over into neuroscience, but are helpful for understanding the different material components of the brain and where they're different and why. So that's pretty fun because we called it our Crystal Brain Project, which is obviously just a great motivating project title.